A very good morning to you and happy holiday for those that are on holiday today celebrating our Muslim brothers and sisters. You're welcome to Off the Press on Plus TV Africa. My name is Felicity Ezewike, but I'm not doing this alone. I have our in-house analyst, Ekene Ezeji. Pleasure to have you join us.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
All right, we'll start with the Daily Sun newspaper. We have quite a number of them here. We'll just start with that one. The screamer is on 60 billion naira constituency projects. Reps prepare for showdown. No cracks among members, says spokesman. We also have the much talked about wagon assembly plant captured on the front page as well. But just before that, let's take a look at what's on your screen. Kanu mom's debt. Obiano, only governor supporting us. That's according to the family. You find details of that on page 40. I did flip there, but I couldn't actually find that story. Maybe the paging wasn't correct. But you go check yourself and get details of that story. At the bottom of the paper, I talked about the wagon assembly plant. And right there it says, coming railway wagon assembly plant to generate 5,000 jobs. That's according to a minister. Details on page 37. And of course, Eid al-Madlud, kidnapping, forced marriages on Islamic. That's the president's message on this special day. Northeast, Otedola donates 5 billion naira to save children. There are some other headlines. So we have the promotions in the military also captured on the front page. On the back page of the Daily Sun, we have something on hate speech, the broadcast media, and democratic freedoms. We'll get to that in a bit, but let's bring Ekene into... Let's okay, you pick. I wanted to draw you straight to the railway wagon, but okay. Which caught your attention first?
Okay, let's look at Kanu Mom's death. It's a bit interesting, let's put it that way, because I read over the weekend that the Imo State governors had banded together to appeal to the president to let Kanu come home and bury his mom. He's the first son. They feel he should be allowed to come in and do the rights of a first son and bury his mother. Loretta, I forget her surname, the president's spokeswoman, was very disdainful of that. She was mocking them, really, essentially, saying, look, how did he get out of the country? The same way he got out, he should come back in. He should go and apply for a visa from the zoo. You know, a lot of mocking going on, belittling the whole situation. Now, nobody is necessarily in support. I mean, we're not trying to say we're endorsing Kanu's movement, but we're trying to say there's a place for civility. You know, his mother has died. Let him come in and bury his mother. That's my position anyway. But perhaps I'm not looking at the bigger picture. Perhaps
yeah, a lot of persons will argue with you on that one. A lot of
he's not a terrorist. He's not been
issues.
Termed a terrorist officially.
The he hasn't group killed has anyone. Been proscribed.
Yes, but he hasn't killed anybody. So, you know, he's still a free citizen in let me not go too far into that. But essentially now they're appealing to the president to let him come back in to
bury
his mother.
Let's see how the president reacts. The spokesperson, I'm sure, isn't speaking the mind of the president as of now. There's been no official statement. So I guess we'll just take it.
It may just die to death. I'm not expecting the president to say very much, just to ignore that and let it stew.
Okay. Okay. Let's talk about the railway creating 5,000 jobs. There's been a whole hula about it.
But again, the much I know is that everyone is looking to see if this railway thing kicks off. A lot can happen. A lot can come out of it. So really, there's all eyes should really be on this development to say if this happens the way we expect, then a lot can, both the transporting of goods, both the relief for the roads, because we know all the roads are in a very terrible state, and just more efficiency and easier transportation for the masses, because railways tend to be cheaper than road and other means and much more direct, let's put it that way, because you're caught between two positions, two points. It's sort of a straight line. So we can only look forward to seeing, because so far, I would say the railway development has gone not badly according to schedule. It's one of those ones, one of those projects that we feel is making progress. Let it be the one silver lining, you know, this year, if they manage to deliver on it.
Okay.
So I'm hopeful.
You know, touching on the reps preparing for showdown, saying constituency project, I don't know. What's your take
when you
on
read
that?
Headlines like no cracks among members, it's almost like a team sport, you know, sort of let's stand together and let's, you know, because they're trying to defend their constituency projects. And we know now that the budget is really it's crunch time when it comes to budgets. We're even hearing things like, you know, there are no funds for roads. You know, we're not even sure they'll be able to pay the minimum wage in a lot of states. So, you know, they're having to stand shoulder to shoulder to insist on some of
money
these things.
Money is involved.
Yes, and people are looking for creative ways to raise money. Money, you know, yeah. So the crunch time.
All right, let's see what's on this day newspaper this morning. The screamer is in landmark gesture. Otedola donates 5 billion naira to save displaced Northeast children. It has two writers, says we all need to reach out and comfort the Sikh. Oshibajo, it's the single largest donation to philanthropy in the country. I do think that is amazing.
It's admirable, it is. But however, I caught my eye that he's going via a British charity, you know, which is not to say anything is wrong with that, but I'm trying to highlight an interest of mine. A lot of times, there's a story amongst all these stories of a young man who's waiting for his NYSC and he loses his sight whilst working as a taxify driver. Now, we now know this guy, you know, to fix even the teeth, the armed robbers ambushed him and shot a gun directly in his face, which also damaged his teeth and he lost his sight. For him to repair that tooth damage, it will cost him 350,000. Now, as a people, I feel we're compassionate, but when it comes to charitable donations, people tend to be a lot more restrained. Why? Because sometimes your caution is, if I put this money here, will it get to the person? You know, so that's the reason I'm highlighting the fact that he's going via a British charity.
Because yeah, but do we have a credible charity organization that this is quite a huge amount of money that has a history of, you know, judicious use of funds given to them?
Exactly. No, you know, we're saying the same thing. We don't have. It's exposing the fact that we lack that accountability. You know, if you go through the newspapers, you find story after story of lack of transparency, of monies that haven't reached, you know, their destination, and people are still trying to, and people who are tweaking the figures, there are many stories, will come to them. So when you see this kind of an amount of money being given to a foreign, let's say, charity via his daughter's copies charity, she sort of is the one tabling the check, so to speak, it really highlights the fact that we don't have confidence. The reason a lot of people may not come openly to put money down for needy projects like this one, this is for the IDPs, is because you're not sure if the money will get to his desk. So which is it's really a sad situation.
Yeah, but it's still, it's a good,
that he's done that, yes. And hopefully it will ginger a lot more of his cronies, people in that salary bracket, so to speak, to do likewise.
All right. We have something on report. Border closure boosts Naira at parallel markets. Obaseki vows to resist old order in Edo State. We seem not to have heard the last of that situation there. We certainly hope there will be a resolution. I worry about the people when we keep hearing about these kinds of, you know, controversy. It's still the people that bear the brunt at the end of the day.
Yeah, you're basically using them in your, you know, game of chess, so to speak. It's a little childish, which is why each time I read about it, I feel it's a distraction. You know, there are more serious issues going on in the States. Like we're saying, the funds are low. We need to be thinking outside the box. We need to be thinking about how to raise money, even for salaries, let alone for development and things that really need to be done. We're even talking at the moment that because of the cash crunch, capital investment, things like education may not get the money they need. And here these two grown men are squabbling over things that really don't bear thinking about. But on the border closure, at least positive news, we hope. It's saying that, you know, it's boosting. But a lot of people have raised issues concerning the border closure. I'm sure you've heard some of them. Are we making commensurate interjections at this time when we've closed the borders to ensure that when we do, because we can't keep the borders closed indefinitely, I think we all accept that, when we do open the borders, we'll have things in place. Because the reasons they give for closing the borders are, you know, smuggling. Those things won't go away. You know, we have too many borders for you to man them, you know, all the time. So you need to be thinking long term. We've closed the borders. What are we doing against the time when we open them again, hopefully by the new year?
Okay, I almost skipped this one. Buhari, violent extremism, Islam single image crisis, condemns killings, kidnap of women, conversion and forced marriage. On the back page, we have Alex Oti talking about conspicuous consumption of our tomorrow today. That's a lovely headline.
It is, isn't it?
You just want to read.
Yeah.
Conspicuous consumption of our tomorrow today.
I think it, yeah.
Yeah, it is.
It gets you thinking. But I'm sure we'll come across the Buhari message.
Thing on extremism.
It's on several of the newspapers.
Let's see if it is here as well. Yes, it is. Mm-hmm. So we'll just take it from the Punch newspaper. I'll start with it, actually. Idom Alud, shun violent extremism, Buhari tells Muslims. Then there's something on fear over cooking gas scarcity as supply drops. Let's hear your thoughts on the Buhari.
Yeah, I mean, I guess you'd say it's the right thing to say. However, when you look at the headline on this day and on other of the newspapers where he talks of, you know, extremism being an image problem, I would actually suggest that it's more than an image problem. You know, you need to look beyond why are these people doing what they're doing. Usually they trace it back to poverty. They trace it back to various things not being in place because it's the youth that, like you say, it's the youth that are being used when you talk of the Obaseki or Shomile thing to propagate some of these atrocities on their own people. And why are they being used for that? Because they don't have any, they're not engaged. They don't have a future, so to speak. So they're trying to carve out their own idea of what a future holds for them. It's like kind of cultism in a sense. You're looking for a sense of power and belonging, and you get that with violent extremism.
So, yeah, there's something you talked about parents that also caught my attention. Okay. Parents might not be doing enough to stop their children from being recruited to extremism. Do you think there is some validity in that?
I think, you know, definitely there is. At least he's thinking broader than just saying it's an image problem, because clearly it can't just be an image problem. We're dealing with something deeper, more deep-rooted. So we're dealing with the way you instill ethics in your children. We're dealing with society and the hope it gives young people growing up as to whether they can actually make a contribution that matters. Because, you know, hope is really something you have when you feel you, if you make a certain contribution, it will reflect. You'll get some gains out of it. But if you're living in a society that tells you that no matter what you do, you'll be trodden on, you'll be without, and that other people will somehow come and leapfrog, then you'll feel tempted to take matters into your own hands. Not that it's right, but we need to look at those, you know, the issues that are beneath the actual extremism that are manifesting on the surface.
Okay, let's come to the picture on the front page of The Punch. If we can have it on the screen, that would be very lovely. The Punch newspaper, the screamer on there and the picture. Yes, that's what I wanted you to see. The picture of the bad roads. And of course, Fashola. If you have been following latest stories, I'm sure you would understand why there is a picture of him inserted in the midst of those photographs. Well, let's see what the screamer is on it. Not that bad. Highways of debt Fashola needs to visit. Okay, if that doesn't clue you in, I don't know what will. Okay, and then there's this one. Hard times looming states. Revenues shrink. Wage bills rise. States have burdened themselves with debts. That's according to a Labour leader. Still under that picture of our dear Fashola, we have Dangote plants $60 million cement plant in Togo. And then Showery, FG only obeys foreign court orders, says Falano. And then we have 29,000 Sikh, 1,500 Ogun teaching jobs.
You have to like The Punch for the way they lay out their stories. I love their picture stories. I mean, I love the fact that, you know, inserted in the middle,
it tells the story.
I mean, it's a pity. It's what most people would term a gaffe, what Fashola found himself, you know, in the middle of. You know, he really ought not to have said that at such a time.
But would you say it's a skeptic comment? Because right on the heels of his saying that, how do I mean, a sarcastic comment? Because like, right now that he said, now you have a headline.
Which tells you that he should have known better. I think maybe he's trying to be realistic. You know, but however, he's not appreciating the temperature, you know, around in the nation at the moment, because there's no way you can say, and a man as traveled as he is, that our roads are not that bad. What is he comparing our roads to? Not that bad as what? You know, so I know he contextualizes it by saying not as bad as people are portraying it to be. What people? You know, we travel the roads. Are you trying to tell us that we're deceiving ourselves? We see these roads. We know how terrible they are. So the thing is not to talk about how not. The challenge he's facing, let's put it this way, is that he doesn't have as much money to walk on the roads as he had hoped. Another senator, Senator Buhari, came out to maybe to try and say what he should have said, which is that he put out, he tendered for 3,800 roads to be fixed, and he only got approval for 500. That must be very disappointing for him. But that's a reflection of the times we're in. The money isn't there.
Yeah, but you shouldn't take it
and
out.
And so to
and
try
say,
and to yeah. try and sort of get us to, you know, how you may want to tell your children, maybe there's no way to say, look, things are not as bad as that. But that's not the tone he ought to take.
We're not children.
Thank you very much.
We're not children. We're a nation of people.
I'm surprised because he's known to be a diplomat. You know, yeah. He's known to be a little more exposed in the way he talks. I'm surprised maybe he's under pressure.
Let's talk about the show.
Ah, my, you know, as if we could avoid
it's
it.
Monday.
It's really terrible. You know, you lose adjectives to describe the whole Showery saga because when you talk about fake news, that's really what's at the heart of it for me, and the governments are going after fake news propagators. The way they've handled this Sowore case, as well as the positive ID, let's put that to one side, tells you that they're not adverse to using fake news when it suits them. Why did they say that when the lawyers... Well, let me defend it. Why did they say when the lawyers came to pick up Sowore on, I think it was Saturday, that they hadn't shown up? Meanwhile, Fanana states clearly that they were there waiting. So that was the reason they didn't discharge him. The courts have said discharge him. And you claim that they weren't there. So they go back and they're there on the dot waiting patiently, expecting to have apprehend their client. Until now, you haven't released him. Now, what's the next thing you're going to say? What's the next excuse?
There's always going to be a rhetoric.
The point is you're playing footloose with the truth. Why tell a lie like that? I mean, who do you think you're dealing with when you talk in those terms? You make statements that can't be verified, and then you still don't follow through on the things that are ordered. It led Falana to say that actually it looks like our government only obeys foreign court orders, because he listed the fact that the PNID saga, the courts, the foreign courts, the commercial courts in the UK, said that they needed to pay 250 million if they were to continue appealing the case. And immediately they paid it within the 14-day period. But now the courts have said release Sowore and Bakare, and they're yet to do that.
Quite unfortunate, really. The story you mentioned about the driver is captured here. Taxify driver awaiting youth service loses sight to robbers. That's a really sad.
Again, very sad. Very, because really here's a young man story. Who is trying to make the most of his time. He's whilst waiting for the youth service, he appealed to his brother-in-law to please help him, which a lot of young people are doing. So he gave him a car, and essentially he'll be paying back from what he earns. And it's on one of those trips, in a traffic situation, that armed robbers jumped on him, and all just because they wanted his phone, which he says he was about to give to them, and they shot him in the face. Now, if not for the passenger in his car took off, obviously very scared, but if not for two policemen, thank God for those policemen who came and took him to the local hospital and were speaking, according to him, kind words to keep hope alive. I wonder where he'd be today, because he was bleeding profusely. So he'd had work done on his eyes, he had work done on, you know, to the much he could. He said it was only by the grace of God. And this is the kind of situation I feel we should rally behind. You know, as a people, we should get behind helping this kind of an individual, just to give him hope that he's not alone, that we're a nation of human beings. But unfortunately, how would you get the money to him and be sure that he gets the money? These are the sort of things that may go through people's minds.
Well, I think we shouldn't just gloss over what the policemen did. When they do good, we should also highlight it.
Yes.
Because if they didn't come in, we keep talking about good Samaritans. They did a job beyond their
And they did it compassionately, because he said they spoke kind words to him, told him to hang in there. You know, so it was more than just doing their job.
All right, I think let's just see what we can do with the papers that we have left. The Nation newspaper has the screamer, Senator, no cash for 3,300 roads in next year's budget. Only 500 captured in budget. We politicize everything. Who is the senator that's talking? I guess it's Senator Buhari. You want to go read details of that one. It's on continues on page 8. Some of it is captured on the front page. What you're looking at now is a picture of, from left, I think, Save the Children, Otedola giving the money out. I think Otedola gives out $5 billion for Northeast intervention, commits life to philanthropy, helping the underprivileged. That's captured there. Bayelsa Kogi 2019, APC will take over Kogi. Bayelsa will rerun Bello. APC in Kogi says PDP. Harsh policies to go in Bayelsa. Attack on SDP flayed. And then at the top, we have the Army, Navy, Air Force lift officers. That's the promotion exercise. Buhari urges Muslims to shun extremism. Ekpeyong Akpabio chased 19,455 votes. Senator Iran poll. That's something for you there on the front page of the paper. We looked at the back now, where we have Atiku's Requiem. How do you pronounce that word?
Requiem.
Requiem, yeah. Atiku's Requiem. We might want to go read that one.
Singing a sad song for Atiku.
Yeah. Amechi's Rail of Hope. That's another one. And then on Hatball, we have Between Ikemefuna and Kanu. Yeah, that just brings my mind to the NTA program we used to have. We have, is it Willy Willy? Ikemefula. No. I think that's Things Fall Apart.
Okay. I'm trying to keep up with you.
Yeah, sorry. Things Fall Apart.
I was going to say it's before my time.
No, it's not before your time. All right, your quick thoughts, quick.
Oh, gosh, I'm trying to think what to pick on now. Just quickly to add on to the senator, he actually went on to say, which you could say in a way makes Fashola look bad, because he said actually the state of the roads are deplorable across the nation. So he is almost like he's trying to take back the statements that Fashola made and say, look, nobody can doubt that the state of the roads is deplorable. However, this is what we're facing. And I hear that some of the creative ways, I think, for example, it's Akwa Ibom or one of those states around that part, are thinking of they said they're tired of waiting for government to build their federal roads. They're planning to build them themselves. And they're planning to put tolls, erect tolls. So, you know, the people get to foot the bill eventually.
Yeah, but if you think about it, do we have a history of accountability? Someone is probably going to hijack that in no time.
Unfortunately, because in a way, people may not even be quarreling with you if you erect tolls, because that way they can see you're going to fix the roads. But some of the challenges we face, even here where we have toll gates in Lagos, when you've paid off the cost of that, where is the money going to? Are you still fixing the roads? Or at some point, will you stop or will you increase the tolls? The greed factor, you know, and the fact that there's not enough transparency usually kicks in.
Bicycle election is upon us.
Yes, and APC are vowing that they've got it in the bag. I don't know why I can't get excited about such stories. It just seems to me like, you know, politics, business as usual.
But do you think we're ready for it?
Are we ever ready? Because bottom line, the only reason I'll get excited by elections is when I see some kind of direct link between our voting and the person elected. If I can see that there's enough transparency to assure us, the average man in the streets, that if I go to the polls, my vote will count, then I'll sit up and say, let's pay attention. But at this stage, you know, anything goes.
Okay, quick look at sports now before we wrap things up. Row prays against injuries. We also have African Heart indeed switches focus to African qualifiers. We also have Rao opened camp today, battle against Bene Lesotho. Eagles coach won't wait for latecomers. Moses Simon is a Nantes player of the month. We have some other headlines on the paper. On the back, we have PSG make initial contact over new Mbappe deal. Tottenham to make £50 million bid for Memphis. All right, you have any thoughts on any of these?
I'm surprised I'm not seeing the story about Liverpool, because I heard that was actually caught my attention this morning.
Yeah.
I was waiting to see it so I could jump on it.
I'm gravitating towards Liverpool, even though I'm not a football fan,
yes.
But for some reason,
they seem to be on a winning streak.
A bit of it. Yeah.
You thought they played well?
Yeah, well, I'm not an expert.
Well, the analysis which caught my interest was that it seems as though they're rigging. And this is me, who always asserts that sports is the one area that you'll see a meritocracy of sorts. Mm. As in, you can't really goof. I mean, you can't hide it. If you're playing well, people will see. If you're not playing well. But apparently, they feel that Liverpool, either through the referee, I didn't follow the story to the end, are somehow trying to tweak things. And so the anger is that they're trying to win at all costs.
Of course. Okay.
So that's intriguing for me. I'll want to follow that story.
Udoka and Cole will come and tell us more
later. I hope they'll talk about that. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Ikenne, for coming on the program.
Thank you for having me.
All right. And thank you for watching. That's about it for the newspapers this morning. Please go get a copy and see what story would catch your interest. My name is Felicity. Do enjoy the rest of your day.